Welcome to CAD with Hayden, which is Hayden Reinhold's handoff for all of his work with ORSAT 0.5 and upcoming one on Onshape, and who was responsible for taking all the SolidWorks stuff and shoving it into Onshape. So good job, Hayden, and thanks for going over this. And this is meant for people new to Onshape and new to ORSAT to kind of ramp up. So take it away.
Yeah. I'm Hayden. I will give you guys a tour of the CAD here. So, starting off, how do you get started with CAD? What you have up here is versions and history. This is kind of one of your starting tabs that you want to look at. This is, if you have any familiarity with Git, this is how we do the version control. This is how you would be able to like take the CAD that we've kind of all worked on and then split off into your own little branch area to be able to do your own work without, you know, being afraid of like messing anything up with anything. And then also just being able to work on spaces separately without having to like step on each other's toes and stuff. So we have a few kind of other developers in here right now. So these are other people that have kind of been doing some work. And then the main branch is kind of the direct branch that has all the, it's like the most up-to-date branch with all of the kind of like finalized changes and everything like that. Some of these other branches might have changes that aren't reflected in main just because they're like experimental changes, but main branch should be the one that like is always most up-to-date, most like ready for use and stuff like that. If you're coming in here and you want to like make a new branch, you want to get started and you're a, kind of a new developer, you'd go over to click on the start here and then branch to create workspace. And then it'll kind of bring up this dialog box. You can say like new developer, and then it'll just create, and then you'll have your own little workspace. You might be like, oh my God, where's my satellite? That's because you have to merge the main branch into your branch. Let me go over that a little bit slower. You have your branch currently selected, and then you just kind of like right click on the main branch. You can do that with any of the other branches too, but if you do with the main branch, that will kind of, that's the main branch, right? So you want the most up-to-date CAD into yours. So you can kind of see that like, obviously these two tabs that we don't have will be deleted. This is kind of like diffing within Git. So it'll like kind of tell you what changes are being made. Obviously, there's nothing in this new branch. So everything is going to have a change and it's all a kind of a new tab, right? So you just click merge. It's coming from main into your new developer branch and you just click merge. And so that'll kind of take a second to just wrap everything up, but then that'll take everything from the main branch, move it into yours. And then you'll have your entire file structure ready to go. And so then let's just say you want to make a new part and you know, you're making ORSAT 3, our mission to Jupiter. So you make a new part like that. I don't know if you want
to. Yes, add... absolutely. Mission to Jupiter.
Yes. If you want to make a quick part, you can just do something like that. You know, I'm sure ORSAT 3 would look better than that, but that's your first part. And so you have, I named it ORSAT 0. I should name that ORSAT 3. If you want to then have that change reflected in the main branch, you're going to go over here and you're going to select the main branch. So as you can see, that file isn't there anymore because you like switched branches. So the new developer branch is its own little workspace that doesn't have, the main branch doesn't have the changes that you just made in your new workspace. But if you want to bring that over, so right click, merge into current branch. You can see that ORSAT 3 is a new change and that'll get merged over. So you just click merge and there you go. So now that change is reflected in the main branch. And then any of the other developers over there will just be able to like merge main into their branch and then have that change reflected. So that's kind of how the group synergy of Onshape works. It's really nice and it deals with merge conflicts great. Like you can have certain parts be more updated than other parts and like not have everything break like Git can sometimes do. It's really nice and it just works. So it's really nice. Kind of explain just a few things over here. This is what you call version. This is the only version that we have just because this version was necessary to create the custom material library. Onshape requires you to create a version to have the material library updated. But in the future, if you wanted to create a version for any reason to like mark a significant thing, like Or Sat Zero isn't like quite ready yet. There are just a few features that are missing before it's like an exact model of what satellite we have in space. If we wanted to create a version then, we could go up here and create a version. You'd want to be on the main branch, because you wouldn't want a version on your branch, because that could kind of create some issues. And then you can kind of name it like or Sat Zero. And so what this does, it creates an immutable like log change in the feature tree. And so then you can always go back to like, this is the state of the CAD when you create the version. And so then if for whatever reason, you know, something weird happens in the future and you like, I need or Sat Zero CAD, you can always just go back in time to this. So like if I wanted to, I can go back over here and I can click on this version when the custom material library is created. This was way back on July 3rd. So like a lot of the stuff that you saw, like the ADCS and all those kind of folders, they're just like, they're not there. Because you're kind of like going back in time. That's like going back to a specific version, but if you really want to, you can kind of go back and you can dig through every single change. You can see that here in the all branches just by clicking these show changes, but you can also do that in your active branch here, and that's a little bit easier to sort through. That the versioning helps kind of control all these changes, because it's really hard to go back and find one specific change of like adding one specific feature. That's why if you want to add a version, it would be helpful to be like, oh yeah, this is exactly when we finish this project. And so that way you wouldn't have to scroll through this entire table. It's not really that commonly useful to like need to go back to like one specific change. It's more common to like maybe want to undo something. That feature is available there if you so desire.
So would it make sense, Hayden, to have a version for Hayden goes off to Blue Origin and hates us forever, but at least we know that that's when you left? Or is it really more centered around the like Orsat Zero model is done, that kind of thing?
I think it would be better to do it based off of like an assembly is done. Okay. Because then you like know that the CAD is like solid at that point. I mean, it can get kind of cluttered if you have a lot of versions here. Yeah. If I can open up the LV4 doc on this, that can kind of get a little bit cluttered. So it's a little bit harder to see what's all going on. But at the same time, it is kind of more easy to go back and see like, oh yeah, this is when we had like the arc clamp rework and all that kind of stuff. So it depends on how you run it, right? Okay. I didn't do that when I was porting all the CAD into here, just because this is all stuff we've already done before. I think it would be really helpful in the future when we're actually doing like new work to be like, oh yeah, this is like when it shouldn't be used as much as a git commit would be used. Like a git commit is really nice because it like tags a thing. If you want to use it that often, it's fine. But it might be really, really hard to see what's going on. I think it should be like, we're completely done and we think that this is like a shippable version, right?
Yeah.
And then you can always go back to that stage.
Excellent.
Yeah. So that's pretty much it for the branching and merging. I'll cover some other stuff here on the left tab just because it's nice. Comments.
Go ahead.
Yeah, no. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Comments are super quick. They're kind of frustrating because they don't merge between branches. If you just saw I was on the main branch and like, why are there no comments? But if you go over to my branch, I've made two comments. And so then you can just, it'll like, when you make a comment, it'll tag it. So view and NCAP assembly. Basically, I was just saying that the connector placement wasn't final. I just kind of threw that in there to make it look like there's a connector in there. And I think I had to get a specific like dimension that I didn't do yet. But if you want to kind of keep track of that for yourself and you can list like tag stuff, it's like super, super nice. Like I think I have yet to put a thermal interface material on the arc lamp thing here. You can just kind of see that it's tagged like that. So it's really nice for like keeping track of stuff, but at the same time, it doesn't merge between branches, which is kind of unfortunate, but really helpful if you want to just kind of like keep track of stuff and notes for yourself with actually tagging stuff in the CAD. That was my spiel on the comments. I don't know if you had anything that you sounded like you wanted to bring up.
Now talk about working back. So you just made a mistake, and let's go back to what you did. How do you go back?
What mistake did I make?
You added Orsat 3.
Oh, yeah. Okay, sure. I don't think I merged from main to my branch. So that's something you should always do when you start off your workflow, when you like launch up, assuming there's a lot of other development going on, you should always merge your main branch into your developer branch. It doesn't really do anything wrong at all. Like there's no chance of anything like being bad or being overwritten. So you should just always do that to make sure you have the most recent changes. So that way, like, you don't end up working with an old thing, like an old frame version, and then like doing a whole assembly, and then you go to merge that back into main when there was actually like a newer version of it. And so it's really important to like stay up to date in your developer branch as much as possible, so that way you don't have stuff like that happening. So Orsat 3, because the change was actually done on the new developer branch, I could delete it here and then I could do that. Or if I wanted to like go back in time, I would go over here and I'd go to my new developer branch, and then I would go like click on this state right here. I think that would be the right state. No, I'd have to go back one more, and then you can see that Orsat 3 is not there anymore. So then I could do restore to new developer. So that's just basically going to bring this change back into the current version of the developer branch.
Pretty great. So that little green dotted line was basically all the changes you had made since merging from or branching from start. Okay, I gotcha. Mm-hmm. Or from main.
Yeah, so that's super nice because this is a new developer branch and we only made 6 changes. But that's really a lot harder to keep track of in this. So that is one of the perks of Git, is that like every little change is a commit, and then you can always like easily go back to that. But it's a lot kind of harder to do that in Onshape. I think you can search your history here. I've never actually tried doing this. Let's try reaction wheels. So I guess I could go to any of the things where it says I changed stuff in the reaction wheels.
Yeah.
So that's kind of nice. I've never used this, so I don't know if this works well, but I guess if you want to find something in there, you could go back in time for that. But then you can always just kind of look at an older version of stuff. I was working on the reaction wheel assembly last night. Maybe this has, it's missing some screws or something. Yeah. So this is when I was putting the screws in. So this specific feature was, this specific change was when I was putting the screws in. So I guess you can kind of use it to go back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
But if you, that's where you should use the versioning to like not have to search through and look at every single feature. If you like get a really complete assembly done, I think that'd be the best way to use that. So anyway, if you're back here and you don't want to break stuff, just return to Hayden, and that'll bring you back to the present day. It'll go back to all your recent changes.
Awesome. Thank you.
Cool. Let's do the file structure next. I don't know. YouTube will get some behind the scenes right here. Should we cut this? Or should we just do like one giant Orsat handoff as in like a super long video? Or do you want to?
So I'm going to try something new, which I probably won't do a good job at, but I'm going to try and break it up. So I was just writing down times that we were done with this, although I don't actually see a time now that I'm trying to look for it. Hold on.
If you're sharing my screen, you might be able to go back and look at the actual time.
Yep. On the computer. I'll just do that.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Cool. So now let's take a look at the file structure of Orsat and just kind of look at how I set it up. And that way you can kind of navigate around and see how everything works. So the very first thing to kind of go over is this top level. So this is kind of like the very top level of the home screen. This is kind of like opening up, I don't know. It's very similar to like a file structure on a computer. It's just the files are not like visually up and down. It's just left to right here. So these right here are assemblies, and that you can go over here and you can create anything in here. You can have a part studio, assembly, variable studio, and it will just appear in this top level. So this is kind of like the very top level, and then these are all folders. So if you want to have maybe a specific ADCS part, you could just take this guy and then drag it into the ADCS, and it'll go in there. And you can also like make a new thing at any point. Something kind of weird and interesting to note is you can only go like 3 folders deep. Like I can't make a new folder when I'm this deep. So Just keep that in mind, I guess. Don't get too crazy with your organization. but yeah, yeah, it's pretty much just as intuitive as a computer. You have a few new type of file things that you might not be familiar with if you're coming from SolidWorks. You have a part studio and assembly, but like that's a variable studio. So a variable studio allows you to do some really kind of fun stuff. It's kind of like defining a global variable when you're programming. So you can pick the name of a variable. You have a couple of different variable types. You have like a length, angle, or a number, or an any. If you do number any, you have to add units. But anyway, you can like have the value here. And then if you want to do a description, you can. So anyway, this one is the one that I use the most often, the PCB thickness. And so if for whatever reason in the future, it would be like, oh, we need a new PCB. And we like update to a new thickness. That will cascade the change through every single PCB because the thickness of the PCB is defined here. So if we go to like the back plane, you can see that the extrude here is using hashtag PCB thickness. So basically that means that the global variable studio is automatically brought in and the PCB thickness is always available to use. So whenever you're like working on stuff, if you want to use any of these global variables, you can. So like some of the stuff like the card width, card wedge tolerance, that was all used in the frames. And so that was able to be used between like the wedges and the frames and all that kind of stuff. So anyway, kind of a useful thing to use, but that's just a different type of thing that you might not be familiar with SolidWorks. The material library, it is in SolidWorks, but it's a little bit kind of hidden. This is like you create your own just kind of like file over here. And then it will give you this. If you want to edit this, you just would do right click and then I think export. And then it'll give you a CSV. I don't have Excel anymore. my license expired. But then you would just take that and you'd like upload it to Google Docs, throw it in Excel Google Sheets. And then you can just add a new column, add in your category name. So you just like put in 204 if you want to add a new material. And then add in whatever your name is and your density. So that's how you would define a new material. And I guess just while we're on the topic, I can show you how to use that. So for our new part here, we'll just we'll remake Orsat 3. If you're a fan of the series, you would know that we made Orsat 3 in the last one. and we'll add a material to that real quick. So when you go over and we have our part now, you have to have a solid part in order to add material, but you go over here and you right click on your part and you do assign material, and then you'll have an option of two different libraries. You have the Onshape material library, and you have the Orsat material library, which the Orsat material library is the one I just showed you. But then you can go in here and you can select any of the kind of custom materials we have, like the FR4 stuffed, or which is basically the generic weight that we have for any of the PCBs, or the WinForm LX 3.0, which is like kind of our generic 3D printed material. So that's how you get to our custom materials. And then if you want to add materials, like I said, you just export it. And then I think you just right click update there and it will give you a chance to upload a new updated CSV.
Good.
That's like the basic kind of stuff there. If you want to be fancy, you can do the Feature Studio. This lets you like program. Which is kind of fun, and you can like make your own features. I didn't dive into that, but anyway, it's an Onshape. Have fun with it if you want.
So actually, quick question. Do we have an example of this Feature Studio? Like, is that how we did the ISO grids on LV4?
No. Okay. That was painstakingly done by hand.
okay.
Yeah. This is a really, really deep dive, and it looks like you can do super, super cool stuff. And like you can open up other people's like feature studios that they've created. So if you just go on the Onshape forums, there's like just crazy stuff that people have done. They have like full 3D parametric models that you like type in an equation and it'll like give you a model for it. It's super cool stuff. And so it's really powerful. Just haven't had necessarily a reason to dive into it because most of the base features cover most of everything.
Perfect. Okay.
Yeah. And the last thing, drawings. And then this will open up. You have a few different templates. We have a PSAS template. This was done by Emilio, which is it's kind of old. If you want to just use like, so over here, if you click on any of the other things, I think, yeah, Onshape will have the most of them. You do like an ISO drawing of like any of these and it'll just kind of like bring you into a drawing here. And then you would just import a part and you can get started with that. But Onshape has some good tutorials on drawings, so I won't bore you with how to do that. But anyway, that's just like the different kind of types of things that you can do.
Sorry, quick question. So we don't yet have a template that we use all the time. We're mostly using Onshape's templates for the drawings.
Yeah, and we've only really done one drawing in Onshape so far.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that would be for the 2U at this point.
Yeah. So I haven't had to do some of the more complex drawing features. Like I've done GD&T just fine it and stuff like that. But Zach, who's another guy that works on this, said that when he was making the frame drawing, he had to like do hatching by hand and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And so anyway, use at your own risk. Maybe SolidWorks might be the better drawing tool. Who knows? But anyway, don't like my advice would be don't try to force it to be the drawing tool and be everything. It's really easy enough to like just export a part and then bring it into SolidWorks and do a drawing there instead of having to like fight with stuff like this.
Good.
Anyway, but yeah, and two kind of last little things that I'll go over here that are special to Onshape is we have a COTS folder, which is consumer off the shelf.
Commercial off the shelf, COTS.
COTS. I thought it would like have a commercial off the shelf parts or something, but yeah, no, it's just commercial off the shelf. So we have connectors, fasteners, and other. Other is just like weird stuff like springs, dowel pins. Like this is our little ejection pin that sits on the bottom of the satellite frames. So this is just kind of like one off interesting parts, like a little inhibit switch. Some of the other things like fasteners, it'll be more organized. You have like nuts, screws, spacers, washers, screws, obviously we have the most. So anyway, this is where you'd find all of the COTS, and you can always upload more. You just go over here and you click import, and then you'd bring in any kind of like new fastener you want just by downloading that off of McMaster Car. And then the connectors we also have, and like separate into RF connectors. So you have all of your like RF bullet connectors. I don't know why that one doesn't show up. But anyway, just for simplicity, I also made an assembly where you just have the RF connectors put together because this is how you'd always use them. So this would be the backplane side of the RF connectors. And then you could also put in the card side of the connector into one of those assemblies. Anyway, this is where you'd find kind of stuff to put into any of your other card assemblies. You don't have to specifically look here. When you're making an assembly, you just go up to insert and you just kind of search whatever you want. So I've made so many assemblies, I remember fastener numbers from MasterCard, which is unfortunate. Then you just like type in whatever you want. And then these are just kind of our standard like M2 screws. So you just click on that and it brings the part in. So you don't actually have to know where it is in the file structure. You just type in whatever you want and it'll show up. The only interesting thing is difference between parts, studios, and assemblies, but maybe I'll go into that in more detail in a different one. Related to COTS, that's a lot of like imports, right? Like we didn't model any of that stuff. It'll bring in something called a CAD import. This is an automatic generated folder, which is just like where it stores all of the imported files. I don't really know what it does with this, but anyway, you don't have to worry about it. This is just kind of like Onshape saying like, yep, it's imported, but this isn't an actual part. But when you import, it'll make the actual part. It just kind of has to keep this here to be like, yep, it's there. So anyway, don't worry about the CAD imports file. That just kind of automatically does its own thing. And when you import a file, it'll just like probably show up on the top level here and you just move it to wherever you want. But yeah, that's it kind of like for the file structure. Unless you have anything, Andrew, you might want to add?
No, open or set, 0.5 for just a minute. And let's like pretend for a minute that we want to go look at the inhibit switch assembly. How would we do that just to navigate around?
Okay. Yeah. That's a good one. So you have a few different ways to do it. If you like know where it is, you can be on the top level here and you can click on folders, by the way, while you're in an assembly, and it's not going to pull you out of the assembly, which is nice. But the inhibits are in the battery card, inhibit switch, and then you can click on any of the kind of specific parts you want there. But if you're like a visual person, you want to be like, okay, well, clearly I know the inhibits are right in front of me right here. If you wanted to click on it, it'll highlight it over here on the left. he'd be like, oh yeah, that's in the battery assembly. So then I could just right click on the battery, well, left click on the battery assembly, right click. I could switch the battery assembly, or if I wanted to like go specifically with the inhibits, this arrow right here will bring down kind of like everything within the battery assembly. So I'll have the inhibit switches assembly, so I can then right click on that and switch the inhibits. That's kind of like the two ways to easily navigate around the file structure without having to like, you know where everything is. You can just kind of like right click on anything. Some of these specific features, obviously that's not a part, that's a, like a feature. That's kind of like a pattern, so that won't bring you anywhere. But if you like right click on any of these things like the assemblies or the parts, it'll just bring you right to where it needs to be.
Good.
And I guess one thing to add, the way that Onshape does, I'll just kind of go over the feature tree. How about that? That's nice and helpful. So on the feature tree here, these are all of the assemblies that we have in ORSAD 0.5. These all show up when you just insert a part. So if you go over here and you do, let's insert the 1U backplane, it'll come in there and you'll have this whole assembly and it'll show up on the left there. So that's all of your parts. And it'll bring in everything, all the like mates and stuff are auto solved just like based off like the old assembly. So you can just take this guy and you move it around, and then you don't have to worry about your connectors like not moving along with that. So it's the same thing as SolidWorks. You have sub assemblies and stuff like that. But the thing that's different is the mating. And there are plenty of Onshape tutorials on mating, so I won't go over I guess like entirely how to use that. But you have your mates up here, and you have a few different types. I will show you how to put a mate, how to put a card into ORSAD, but that's a different tutorial, which I'll go into a little bit later. But basically, just to go over it, like this is your mate features, and then this is like your instances of like different kinds of stuff. So anyway, when you bring something in over here, you won't have any mates for it, and then you'll probably put the mates down here. When you make mates, it'll just auto name it, and it won't have these really nice names that helps you know what everything is. So please, when you're putting in mates, name it so that way, for your own sake, even you know where it is. Because otherwise, you can imagine digging through 35 things called planar mate one, planar mate two. Very hard to know what it goes to. So as you can see, like all these are like CFC mates, and so it's really easy to go through there. Anyway, that's the feature tree for an assembly. Feature tree for a part is like exactly the same thing as SolidWorks. So if you're familiar with any other kind of CAD software, it should be straightforward. So anyway, I will delete the 1U backplane because it's a 2U satellite. And then, yeah.
Good.
Cool. I would call that good for the file structure.
Okay.
I was going to dive into the frames.
Please.
All right. So here we have ORSAD 0.5. This is a 2U satellite. And then over here we have ORSAD 0, which is a 1U satellite. ORSAD 0 is already in space, and so we've made some changes to the frames in the meantime. So we have kind of like an old version, a legacy version of the frames, and then a newer version of the frames. What we sought to do is kind of keep all of that in one giant part file. So that way, if any kind of changes in the future, like the V2 changes happen, it'll cascade through every single other frame version. Right. So ORSAD is trying to be a scalable platform where you can do a 1U satellite, 2U satellite, 3U. We even have like a 1.5U and, everything in between. Right. So if you want to be able to do that, it'd be really nice to have like one part file that shows you all the different versions of the frame. So that's exactly what we have here. If you go up to the top of the configurations, this will kind of show you everything that we have here. So we have it separated out between the old kind of legacy frames here and then the V2 frames. The V2 is what we're kind of like moving forward with, just because it's has a better design for the card wedges and stuff. But you can click on any of these guys and it will just auto-generate based off the giant feature tree here. And it will give you like the 1U, or it'll give you like the 2U, or it'll even give you the 3U. And so it's really nice to have all those, have it all within one part file. So that way, if you change one little thing, it'll cascade. But if you have to make gigantic changes, it can be a real pain. And one of the things that happens is like some of these things that are like meant for like one specific thing. Like this is the V2 frames for the 2U. It's like this guy's getting cut off, and you can see some of the other like errors generate. So to be honest, it is a lot to maintain. If you get it to a point where it is like completely up to date, then then it's really nice. If you just have to make one little change, it'll cascade through everything, and you'll make sure you don't miss anything. Like if you happen to miss just like one little dimension on one frame, it can like completely mess up the assembly and like void it because it's such a coupled system, right? So that is one of the advantages of having this. One of the disadvantages is having to manage the configuration table. So over here is your configuration panel. This will show you all the different kind of features. So I think it might be best to start off a little bit towards the top here and kind of show how this was all done. And I'll kind of like walk through the feature tree. So this right here is just how you like go back in time, right? We'll go to the 1U frame, I guess. So we only have variables defined right now, but these were just kind of some of the basic generic variables that we had to have to get stuff going. So start off with just making an orthogrid, and then this orthogrid is able to be like patterns between the 1U, 2U, and 3U. That's kind of like the thing that is common between the satellites, and then we try to make it scalable per U. So then you'd be able to put like a solar panel on each of these U's, stuff like that. Few variables right there, which are super helpful: frame height and frame width. So that way because when you change between configurations, some of the geometry isn't the same. If you want to use something that like uses the total height, I would recommend using one of these variables, which is like auto-generated from like adding some of the other variables together. If you see in here, it's like adding the height of one of the U's plus the U number times the U number. So it's like the height of one of these times 3 plus the spacing and stuff like that. So I'll just kind of keep walking down the feature tree. You have your orthogrid, and obviously you got to connect it. So you have the spacing there. This guy's a little bit broken just because of the V2 changes. That guy just translates it over to the center. So then what this does is it adds some of the kind of beginnings of the internal card slot volume. So this kind of like perimeterizes around like where the backplane goes. If you kind of know that the backplane sits raised above the minus X. And this is also similar for like the Y frames and stuff like that. It's kind of like a case around the card slots. And then moving on to the card slots, that's what we did next. A lot of the stuff, it'll just basically pattern the different card slots. And so that'll automatically kind of populate between 1U, 2U, and 3U. And so it's nice to be able to have a feature like this, just get patterned across everything. But for moving between like the 1U and 2U, there's two patterns here on the 2U versus the 1U. So it's more features to maintain. It was a nice idea, but anyway, a kind of a repeated theme we've come up with is it's a lot to maintain. So in the future, could be better to move to the way that we've done it in SolidWorks in the past, which is like one file per frame. I think it should be up to whoever ends up working on this next if they want to take that on or not. I think it was nice to do this because it gave us a really good kind of cohesive view of ORSAT to be like, oh yes, a few of these features are like different between them. So it was nice to kind of get that view of having to do it like this, but at the same time, it's a little weird. So up to you in the future if you want to work on that or not. But anyway, I guess I don't need to go through every single thing here. But each of the folders is pretty nicely named. So like this is covering the minus X backplane. So that'll like give you the bumps and all that kind of stuff. And like the rails will obviously give you the rails. And then a lot of these other stuff is like specific for 3Us, all that kind of stuff. So try to name everything in folders as much as possible. So that way, if you have to edit a specific feature, you go into that folder. That's where that is. And then this giant configuration table is how you would control between versions, right? So if you look at whatever this feature is, the 3U inner orthogrid spacing, it's only active for the 3U. So basically you'd go up to like configure features and you want to configure your fillet right here. And the way that I was mostly doing this when I was creating it was I would configure suppression basically. So then that'll bring the feature at the very end here. So then if you don't want that frame fillet to be on the 1U, say it's like only a 3U type of part, you just uncheck that, and then you can see over there it gets suppressed. So that's kind of how you'd use a table like this. It's a lot to learn and it's a lot to dive into. And it's complex and it might be more hassle than it's worth. And I know I'm not selling it very good.
It's one of those things that's a double-edged sword. And
yeah.
I hear what you're saying, which is it may not be worth it in the future, but it's pretty amazing to be able to generate all three from the same model and know you've got the same thing. So that is a feature.
Yeah, it is nice, right? It's like you don't have to worry about like the skin thickness being different between this model and like a 2U because it's all right here and it all generates in the same thing. So it's nice to be able to have that sanity check. Maybe what would be best is now that this is done, you're like, okay, we've done our sanity check. Now let's go part this out and make like the 1U, 2U, 3U.
The only problem is that we're going to change everything, you know, in 3 years.
Yeah, right?
Yep.
So, yeah. This was really nice to build up from existing CAD, but I'm not sure how well it works for going forward. So anyway, this is kind of a note to anybody out there who might be working on this. I'm not attached to it. So feel free to break it, feel free to change it, feel free to completely throw it out the window and start anew. I think it should be done the most efficient way. And because this is a kind of different development state than like active development, it's like, you know, just porting stuff over, this might not be the best solution, or it might be even better solution. Who knows? But anyway, just
try
and stay open to changing that in the future. But anyway, that's the frames. I'll go over the frame assembly because this is super cool. So we have the legacy frames and then the 2U structure assembly. The legacy frames includes the 1 and 2U, and then the 2U structure assembly is like for the V2 stuff. This generic 2U was kind of used just to show where cards are and stuff. But Onshape, this is really cool. This is some nerd shit. It's really fun. Onshape has this thing called Replicate, which is super cool, and it will like match the face of anything and like auto-populate it, right? So what I have here is I have a mate for the M2.5 screw, which basically just like says this screw goes here. And then I'll have this guy right here. This replicate feature will just put that fastener everywhere it needs to go. It'll just like automatically know like, okay, that hole, wherever that hole is, it'll put that fastener. Super cool stuff because you have a 1U and 2U. And so a 2U has more of those frame holes. So if you just click on 2U, it'll automatically generate. And like I used replicate on everything else too. Like I used it on the card wedge fasteners as well as the card wedges. And so when the 2U loads, it does take a minute to load. And you'll see that it just like literally completely auto populates everything, and it's super cool. But it is always awkward when it loads a little bit. I don't know if you want to edit in Jeopardy music, but yeah, anyway, it's super cool. So, like, it'll just auto populate all those screws. It's fun stuff. But that way, you don't have to go through and do every single mate. This works well for the legacy kind of wedges and stuff like that. Which has the individual part for the triangle. I suppose I should do a section view, that'd be better. I should go over that menu, that'd be helpful. But it has the individual triangle and stuff. So that this is the older version. And the way that we have set up the file structure is we have these assemblies where we would put in all the fasteners, all the wedges, all that kind of stuff, and basically all the mechanical hardware in one assembly. So that way a big assembly like Orsat 0.5 isn't burdened down by all of these features and all these mates. It's kind of, you kind of almost have your own file structure within the feature tree, right? Because if you did everything in one top level thing, it would be awful to try and keep track of everything. So that's why you have like the battery assembly over here. You have the battery card, which is its own assembly, which has its own features. And you have your inhibits, which is its own assembly with its own features. If you tried to do all this in one assembly, it would be unbearable to keep track of. So that's kind of the rationale why you do all these sub-assemblies. And then specifically for like the 2U structure, that's why you have this, because this is the V2 stuff. So this is even more complex, and you have to have a lot more little kind of one-off things just because of how the new things require mating and stuff.
That's really awesome.
Yeah. And so that is one thing that helps you kind of keep track of stuff. So this is the V2 structure assembly. As you can see in Orsat 0.5, there's like some weird bugginess going on here. This is a thing that I encountered with Onshape a lot, in that I think what the problem, so these wedges are there, right? If you want to play spot the difference, those wedges are here and here. So, and you also cannot move them. So Onshape has this weird thing that I think what the problem is when you fix a part in a subassembly, that fix does not get carried over to the master assembly. So you should always not fix parts and like fully mate them. It's just kind of weird that it does that, but kind of an annoying thing that you have to go through and fix. But I think that that would be the reason why you're kind of seeing that weirdness in 0.5. That's kind of it for the mechanical part of the structure, but I do want to touch on the backplane. It's because the backplanes are defined off of the structure. And so I guess we'll start off with the base PCB model. So this is another parametric kind of configuration thing. Is the
So quick question, yeah. The base PCB model, that doesn't also include the cards. This is just for the backplane, correct?
Yeah, I'll do the cards next.
Okay, so this really should be called base backplane model.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Yeah, actually, you know what? If you want to make a note to split it here, maybe that'd be better. Because it is a little bit different. So this is kind of how we've done the backplanes. The backplanes are controlled in a similar way as the frames, except the configuration table is not as awfully large because there's less features. So we have the same configuration table, 1U, 1.5U, 2U, and 3U. A lot less features, so there's a lot less stuff to control. But basically, there's different parts here because these parts are where you would do the specific drawings for anything like mission specific. This model right here should be used exclusively for the geometry. So the geometry of the backplane will be consistent between every mission. You'll have different connector locations and all that kind of stuff, but this should be consistent between every single 2U mission, just like the 1U should be pretty much consistent with every 1U mission. It auto-generates for the height and stuff like that, but what isn't included is connector locations, and that is where we use these different kind of parts right here. So what these parts are doing is it's pulling in this other model right here as a derived part. So you can see right here, it's just the derived feature. If you want to do that, you just do import. I think it's derived. Yeah, so derived feature, and then that'll let you bring anything in here. So if you want to do the backplane, you gotta spell it right though. This would like let you bring in a part and then kind of edit stuff off of that. So the reason for doing this as a separate part is so that way, like what this is the kind of layout that the electrical engineers would use to be like, where the hell do I put my connectors? If you'd have this all in one model, it'd be like horrible to try and keep track of everything. So by having this in just separate models like this, it helps you keep track of stuff. But by doing the derived part, it will still like keep a link to the very first thing. It's basically like in programming, if you like create a class and then you like import that class and you do like a derived class for the next one, it'll keep all the same features and it'll just let you update anything further on that. And so if I go in here and I like completely change the geometry, it would still update in here, but this one would also still keep any of the connector locations and stuff. The important thing is for how we generated this backplane sketch is these arrows right here. So what these are meaning that it's connected to an assembly. So you can see up here, assembly context. This is specific for the backplanes because you have to create an assembly context in order for it to be here, which I'll show you how to do in a second. But if you want to see how it was defined, you just go up here and you click 1U backplane. And it will load the in-context assembly. And so then you'll kind of see that these orange guys are active. And then we'll show you the assembly. You can see that like, oh, where are my cars and stuff like that? That's because you have to go into the assembly to update some stuff. For now, this was just, I had it on the minus X, so that way I could do this little perimeter. But in order to actually define that, I'll bring you over to the assembly. I guess that would be better. So I have the folder here called backplane definitions. This is where I was basically defining every single connector and location. So I have one for the 1U2, thinking around on the 3U yet, just because that was kind of subject to change. So the 1U backplane, pulls in the frames, and then mates the backplane to the minus X, and then from that, and brings in some generic card assemblies, which I'll cover the generic cards in a future video. but having these guys just made it into the satellite like they would, so it's touching to the top register of the card slot, and then also registered to our other mechanical register, which is the side kind of like chamfer on the minus X. So once those two are in place, then let me go in here and update context. So these are the in assembly contexts that I was just showing you. But as you remembered, it only had the minus X frame. So basically, if you hide any of these parts and then you do update context, that'll reflect in the subassembly. So then if I go in here and I right click again and hit edit 1E backplane, and then it shows the in context assembly, it'll show you all the same stuff. So the reason it was only showing the minus X before is because I didn't have all the other stuff updated in the assembly. But from here, this is how I was doing all the connector locations. And so you can just see where the actual connectors are. So, you know, like grabbing that kind of center point, which is concentric with the actual RF connector plug, and then just porting that over into a sketch on the backplane, and then doing the same thing for the card connectors. That is all kind of stored in the connector location sketch here. And then that is how you're able to generate the DXF. The other important thing is on top of that, this is the locations for the DXF for the electrical engineers, but it's also the locations to actually put the connectors on the backplane. So these are mate connectors. This is a pretty unique feature to Onshape that isn't really familiar. It takes a while to learn, but let's add one. So what this does is it allows you, it's kind of like doing the foundation work for an assembly that makes it like unbelievably easy. So this is the one used meant for the Orset Zero. There are no auxiliary connectors, but let's just do one of the backplane connectors. If I know that I want a backplane connector right here, I can just create that mate connector and then put it right here. And then basically that's because you can't show sketches in assemblies. This is the only way that you're able to like define the location of a component within an assembly. It's a little frustrating, a little bit weird to get used to, but it is kind of nice. So let me show you what that just did. So within our 1U backplane, I already have a pattern of these connectors, but let me get rid of that main connector pattern. So this guy, we'll pull it in real quick. This is the main backplane connector. And so I already defined a mate connector on this guy as well as here. And so I know that from that sketch, this is where I want the backplane connector to be. So I can just go up here, fasten mate, and click the mate connector on there, right there. And then that will be, I gotta rotate it around. Sometimes it does that. But that way I know that this mate connector and this backplane connector is exactly where in our backplane definition model, it like lines up exactly with the card. So that's the process for kind of constructing where you would put your connectors. And then also, because then this is verifiable in the mechanical CAD. If you go back over to like Orset Zero and then you put the whole thing together, then you can go in here and then you can take a look at like, oh, did my connectors actually line up? And then you can see that they do. So that's the whole kind of backplane process. Our electrical engineer, Andrew, do you have any questions on the line here?
No, that was actually pretty cool. I didn't realize that's how those were constructed. So awesome.
Yeah. It's nice because it auto generates and stuff like that. So that backplane definition, right? If you change anything with the frames, if you happen to move any of your card slots up like a millimeter or something, mm-hmm. it should keep everything here. And so your changes just kind of cascade through everything. So this will get bumped up, your card location will move, and then the actual sketch on your in-assembly context for like the backplane there will update. And that will go over to your 1U backplane, and that'll update. So there's kind of like a little flow chart there, which is kind of cool.
Nice.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. One thing I should really mention. Electrical engineers want DXFs. So if you want DXF, right click, on the connector location sketch. And right now I have them as two separate sketches for the frame location and the connector location, just because if you happen to mess one of these up, it'll break the whole assembly and won't like break it, but you'll just have a little error bar there for like ever. And that was a glitch I wasn't able to figure out. So anyway, if this is a massive pain, we can port it into one thing. But you just right click on this, export as DXF, and then you name it DXF, export it. And that's exactly how you would do that. Same thing goes for like the 2U. You just right click on any of the sketches and then export as DXF. And that's how the electrical engineers get what they need.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah, that's it for the backplane.
Good.
Okay. I think last step is cards. So if you watched the previous backplane video, you know kind of how the parametric stuff and derived parts work. Cards take it another step further. So let's dive into it. That was fun. So start out in a similar manner by having a base PCB definition. This
so
is
not to be obnoxious, but this should really be called card definition, right? Love it.
Yeah. I guess.
Or base card definition, because it's the base card.
Yeah, sure. Sorry, one more end there. So this is the base card definition. It defines all of the geometry for the basic card that we use in ORSAP. So the whole point of ORSAP, right, is you have this basic card that is completely customizable to whatever subsystem you want. You can put like a camera on here, you can put magnetorquers, whatever you'd want on your card, and antenna, and it all uses the same architecture, and you just kind of like slide it into your card slot, right? So what this whole cards folder does is allows a lot of flexibility in that, and while keeping everything central. So if we happen to like make one change to the frames and we got to change the card because of that, all of that geometry change would be done in this base card definition file. And then that would cascade to any of these further cards, which would in turn cascade to any of the assemblies that you make, like the battery assembly, stuff like that. So the only really kind of important thing with this guy is you have two configurations. You have the basic card, and then you have the RF card, which just has the little cutouts for the RF connectors. There is a surface here. I was trying to do some FEA stuff. So anyway, if you want some surfaces for FEA, there is a little FEA folder, but we'll get to that later. Some of the cards, this is just there. You don't really have to worry about it. Onshape will create parts and it will create surfaces. It'll create curves and stuff. When you're working on geometry in Onshape, you always just want to focus on the parts, mostly, unless you know what you're doing. So similar to the backplane, what we do is we take that this base card definition, and then we port that into a few different other part files. So we have our standard card PCBs. So this is like anything you can think of that doesn't have an RF connector isn't like special. It's really just you plug it into the backplane, and it's probably, I would assume, electrically simple is what I would classify this stuff as. So the parts that I have defined for here, you have like your CFC card, your battery card, or your star tracker. Maybe someone will be like, what? CFC card isn't electrically simple, but I think the connection is because there's no RF stuff.
Yeah, better said.
Yeah. So the way that this is defined is same kind of configuration table, but it's just configuring specific features for each of those cards. So this is the standard card right here. It's just ported in just like the backplane was, and then selected for the non-RF configuration. If you see this little blue checker mark thing, that just means it's a configured part. So that means that if I go in here and I, where is it? No, that's it, not it. If I right click on that and let's change configuration. Oh, I just have to edit it. Yeah. And then if I wanted to, I could bring in the RF card, but that's not the point of this module. So in order to define the specific geometry for each of like the kind of subassemblies, you do that all within this part. So if you want to take a look at the star tracker part, we just right click on that, switch, switch to star tracker, and then you can see that the geometry updates to have the little cutout for the star tracker. So this is done kind of two ways. Initially, you know that you want like a sketch that's just like, you want to cut out this big, and so you make your cutout that big. And then you make your cut, your fillets, whatever you want. But the thing is, here is this is an in-context assembly. So like within the context of, oh, yeah, gotta go to the Star Tracker card real quick and update that. So if you go in here and you update assembly context, I think I showed you guys that on the back plane. It'll just update that to show more of the stuff. So when you're in the Star Tracker assembly context, it should show you the whole Star Tracker assembly. And so it's using this whole pattern right here is just defined from having all of your thing all at the same time. So that way you know that the holes are lined up in the PCB, like they're lined up in the assembly. So that way you kind of know that everything fit checks and it's automatically generated. So if you change the hole location on your Star Tracker 3D print, it'll change the hole location on the Star Tracker card. So that's nice to know. But basically, it's something to keep in mind that there's are going to be a few different assembly contexts working in here because we're working on the battery and the CFC. So like there's a battery in context assembly as well as a Star Tracker card in context assembly. So if you're working on the Star Tracker configuration, you should probably be in the Star Tracker card in context assembly unless you know what you're doing. But basically the configuration table over here defines like what features are suppressed or not. That's the only thing that's configured between these things. So as you can see, I named them all pretty helpfully. Like all of the Star Tracker features start with Star Tracker. So you know to suppress all those. And then switching to the battery, all the battery features start with battery. And so between the features, basically you would want anything unsuppressed for the battery configuration to be named battery. And anything named Star Tracker, you'd want like for the Star Tracker configuration, you'd want that not there. So that's why when you switch to the battery, only the features that are checked right here show up. It's so like all the hole locations, all that kind of stuff. That's how you do the basic geometry. Something to keep in mind is the name for this part is not directly correlated to the name down here. That is separately controlled in this configured properties tab over here. And then that is for each configuration over here in the configurations table, it'll name something over here. So let's say we want to make a new PCB called, we're making like a VHF card. Don't worry about the features for now. Over here in the configure properties, it'll bring you into VHF configuration, and you're like, it's not called the battery VHP, the battery PCB, you want to call it the VHF PCB. So then if I go over here and I switch to the VHF, you can see that updates the part name over here. So that's just something kind of interesting that you got to keep in mind, but it is useful at the same time. That's basically how the configurations work. It'll work the same for the RF cards. The only thing is for the RF cards, a little bit further down in the assemblies, there's more of them like the GPS and stuff like that, which don't necessarily have different geometry, but they have different names. And so I'll make use of that same configuration property table in just a second to show you. But the reason that we have three different guys here is just because otherwise the configuration table would be really big and the feature tree over here would be really large to like be like, oh, this is every single card in a folder. It could be a little bit cumbersome and you could step on each other's toes a little bit. So dividing it up into these different categories, like this is all the RF cards. So this would be anything like DX Wi-Fi, GPS, or anything of the sort like that.
Point out the where the RF connectors go, just so people see it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So these are the RF connectors, which kind of makes it special. I'll show you guys that in just a little bit in the assembly. But the geometry for the RF board is just like ever so slightly different. And so that's why I kind of separated into this. The end card PCB also kind of has like some basic different geometry, as in it just has the holes for the solar connectors. And so that's why it's divided up a little bit different like that. And plus there's a lot of different end card assemblies like the turnstile and the helical and stuff like that. So it dividing it up like this kind of just helps keep things sane, but it's all the same workflow as I just showed you in the standard card PCBs folder. It's just per different configurations. So
cool, good to know.
Yeah, taking all of that and going into the assemblies, this is like one step above that. And so what all these are doing is it's pulling in that basic card, the standard PCB. So that is pulling this in from the standard cards PCB folder for the standard cards assembly. The RF card assembly is pulling in the RF PCB from the RF cards PCB. And then the N cards is going to be pulling in the N card PCB from the N cards PCB folder down here. So each of these assemblies is linked to those specific cards. And the reason for doing that is because over in your configuration table, you can automatically change the configuration of that PCB. So if you remember in the standard card PCB, we had the battery and the star tracker and the CFC. And so over here, we have the same thing where we have the standard star tracker, battery, CFC, and then we're just editing the configuration. So when you switch between your configurations to like your star tracker configuration, it'll automatically update the geometry of the PCB while keeping the like base connector on there. So same thing for like battery, keeps the base connector, all that kind of stuff. It's really nice. For the standard card, I also have the auxiliary connector unsuppressed. And then that allows you to do the same thing for like the CFC or the CFC octable card.
Yeah, good. Okay. So that's, which is the only place we use the aux connector. So you've defined these standard cards now based on the standard card PCBs. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Cool. It's a little bit different than we did in SOLIDWORKS, and it's a lot nicer to do it this way because in SOLIDWORKS, every single card assembly had us putting in the connectors. By doing it this way, all the geometry is stored in one part file, which is a little bit more cumbersome to like dig through this little feature tree, but it's not awful, right? I would say it's less awful to do this than it would be to make sure the placement of these connectors is right on every single assembly.
Right. No, totally agree. We won't screw it up, hopefully.
Yeah. So that's super nice. And so that same workflow in the standard cards is just carried over to like the RF cards and stuff. RF cards is just a little bit different though, because we have more configurations that don't really have geometry changes. The only geometry changes are, I guess, like which connectors they use, right? So for the GPS card, these are our three RF barrel connectors. So if you switch the GPS card, you'll see that only the middle guy is available there. Whereas if you switch to the C3, you'll have the other two guys there. And then when you have your configured assembly properties, that's just that same thing where you have like your GPS card and your C3 card, even though those, the only difference there is that they have different connector placement, it'll still update like the name of the PCB and stuff like that. That's that. And I don't think the ADAX card is supposed to be here. I don't know why that's there. So anyway, delete that real quick. Same thing for the N card. There's a mid card. I'm not sure if this is like fully updated yet. This was kind of a work in progress by Jack when we were working on this. But we wanted the same kind of philosophy to be for the end cards, basically just for the mid cards. So there was going to be a mid card without RF connectors. There was going to be like a plus Z end card and then a minus Z end card where the connectors are on the bottom and stuff like that. And yeah. So to take this, everything that covers here, these are kind of generic cards that don't mean anything, right? Like, sure, you have the geometry that you want of like a star tracker, but to actually bring this into the star tracker is a little bit different. So I was going to walk through how to like make a card real quick, make it like an assembly. I think that would be helpful. I'll do it in the cards folder because I think that'd be helpful. So I think I've already made an Orsat 3, but let me just make a little block here that I want to put on a card. This is a really high-tech experimental card that we want to have here that's flying this block into space. So we'll just name this part S part and bring parts together too. Okay, so we have some part that we want to put on a card. Usually it'd be like a 3D print, an antenna, something like that you want to put on a specific card. What you're going to want to do is you want to create an assembly, and we'll call this test assembly. And then we'll bring in, I guess it depends on what kind of card you want this to be. Let's make it an RF card. So we'll go over here and we'll type in RF card, and that should bring up this assembly down here, right? Which was the kind of generic definition that I showed you. So we'll have our generic RF card. You can just bring that in for now. What we're going to do is we're going to make a new configuration for this test assembly. So we bring that guy in, and then we're also going to bring in our test parts. So we'll do that. And then let's just say that we want this guy in the middle of our card. Like that. Okay. And so we have this together, but this is a generic card and a test part. So what we want to do is we want to go into our generic. We want to start kind of at the lowest level and work our way up. So we go to our standard card PCBs because that is the type. Oh, no, it's an RF card. Sorry. We start with our RF card PCBs. And then we go over here and we make a new configuration and we'll call this test config. And so because we don't want any of this other cutouts and stuff like that, we'll just basically uncheck everything here because these are all DX Wi-Fi specific things. So when we switch to this configuration, it should just be basic geometry, right? And then we'll also go to our configured properties and call this test config. So now that'll show our test config PCB maybe. That'll show that there. And now we go up one more level. So we have our basic PCB. Now we go to our RF card assembly. And then we should make a new one called test card assembly. And then again, we'll change our RF PCB configuration to that one we just made, which is the test config. So then when I switch to this, there should be no weirdness, no geometry changes. And then, I don't know, I can put on as many barrel connectors as I want. I can put on that auxiliary connector too. Why not? So that means that this test card assembly will have all of those features in it, and it'll be entirely, it's like a separate instance from all those other guys. It's all separately controlled. Real quick then, if I want to go back into my test assembly and I want to edit this PCB based off of this assembly and I want to like make a cutout where that is, this would be really applicable if you want to like make a fastener hole, right? I can go in here and I can, where is it? Oh yeah, I have to click on the RF PCB and then edit in context. And then that'll let me just like create a little in context thing here. So I'll create a sketch on the top of the PCB here. And we'll just port this all over into that assembly. And then we'll just cut through it. We'll just go through all down here. Okay. And we'll just close.
Yeah, sorry, what would you call this? You'd call this making a context assembly, right?
Yeah, this is an in context assembly. I mean, you could do like a little cut like this, but that's not very applicable. What would be applicable is you have a fastener hole in a part, and you want to make sure that that fastener hole shows up in your PCB.
Yeah.
So we'll name this, you want to name stuff to keep it as organized as possible. Sketch. And then we'll just name that same thing there. So then, because we have new features here, these features will show up for whatever configuration we're on. And we don't want that, right? We want the DX Wi-Fi to remain the DX Wi-Fi. So we'll go up here, configure features, and we'll configure just the suppression of it because the suppression basically turns on or off that feature. And so we'll go over here to our configuration table. And we want this test config sketch to be only like test configs, just like multiplication tables. You go down and to the left. Just uncheck all those guys. And so then leaving the checks only for the right assembly. So when we switch to that, it'll have our slide right in there. And so then this is an entirely separate instance from our DX Wi-Fi and our generic RF card. And so it's all, you know, all still updated. So this, if we update the base card definition, it'll still update this. If we update like the material properties, it'll still update this. And then if we update the RF cards in any ways, like, I don't know, say we move our connector location or anything, it'll all update within this assembly, which is just like super nice. So you can't actually see the cut we made there. Now what we have to do now is we have to change the configuration in here. I forgot to do that to our new configuration for everything to pop up. So that's our test card assembly. And so now everything kind of works. that's basically how you would go through and you'd make a whole new card and have everything updated and kind of auto-generated and stuff.
Awesome.
Yeah. That's kind of it. I can show you guys how on the backplane, or like the battery, it's using that same thing. So we have our battery card assembly, which is just that this isn't actually the battery card assembly. This is that same generic standard cards assembly. It just has the battery configuration selected with all the cutouts and stuff. So that's how it's used. Same thing for star trackers, same thing for pretty much everything. And so that means that when you go to Orsat Zero, All of these things with like the blue little config like that means that they're using an assembly like that. So it's really nice. Like the entire OrSat is built up like that. So everything will kind of auto-generate.
You can see the end cap isn't quite right there.
Yes.
Can you go to the end cap and we'll just take a quick look at that?
End cap, or you want the end card? Sure, we'll go to the end cap. So the end cap was going to have the same philosophy. If you want to do it that way, you know, if you make a config, you can make a config for the minus the end cap plus the end cap, and you can keep that all in your one file. So that way, for the end cap assembly, all of your fasteners, and you can also change out your connectors and stuff like that.
Gotcha. So the end cap configuration assembly hasn't been done yet.
That's right. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I only have one, which has the patch antenna for the OrSat Zero.
Awesome.
Yeah. And while we're on the topic of cards, I'll just show you the solar cards real quick. It's done in a similar manner. So again, that's one of those services I did for FEA. But so you have this. This is the basic geometry, and then you can scale that up to 1.5U if you want. And then you just bring that into the solar module assembly. And then it's that same thing. It's adjusting the configuration of the base PCB to be able to switch it between a 1U and a 1.5U. And the fasteners patterns are a little weird. Maybe that's stick to the 1U. That's the only one we're flying anyway.
Right. I hope we never fly the 1.5U. So that's fine.
Yeah.
So tell me why the screws are in this assembly and not the main assembly, just to clean up the main assembly?
Yeah, pretty much. Like you would have more mates in the main assembly. You'd have more like patterns. You'd have all kinds of stuff like that. That would be like separated between, that would be like all within this feature tree in OrSat Zero. You can see that these are already really, really long, and it's kind of hard to figure out what's going on. But at the same time, like it's not unbearable. But if you had every single, like there's 11 mate features in this assembly, 11 in this one, like 12 in there.
For example, go ahead and hide one of the solar assemblies.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah, so, nice. So it hides all the other stuff too. Okay, great. Good. Mm-hmm. That's nice.
Yeah. If you had all of that in the main assembly, this would just be unbearably long. You wouldn't be able to find anything.
Yep. Good.
But I do want to show how I've been doing the mating for these large assemblies, just because I think it's nice to have that standardized. Okay, let me pull in our test assembly that we just made. We'll put our test assembly in OrSat. Wow. Just move that out of the way, because if I section view it, it'll be gone otherwise. So there are three mechanical defining mates for the cards that we want to make sure are kind of like hit, so that that way everything else will line up. So first of all, we're going to select the top surface of the card. And then we'll select the top surface of the card slot. So that's the kind of mechanical register for where it would go. The card wedge would push it up. If you press this little button, it'll just rotate it around. So it's in the back. It's like that. And then we have the two minus X angles. So we'll select this kind of angle on the card wedge, on the card, sorry. And then we'll select this back guy. And so what I'm doing right now is a planar mate, by the way. That just basically means that it's like parallel to that. It's like in the same plane. And then finally, the card always sticks through the side here, which makes it a little bit easy. So we did the minus X on the left right there. And then we'll do the minus X on the right, which is this angle right there. And then we have our card fully defined in the assembly here. And you can see that the RF connectors line up. And then you can see that the back main connector lines up pretty well there too.
I have to just say that's so beautiful. It makes me want to cry that you actually like you actually choose the three places it's supposed to mate as the mate points. That's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. It makes it, you know, real. It's nice. And then if you want it to be organized, which you should name this like test assembly card slot. And then you can name this one like, you know, minus X left, and then for the test assembly, and then minus X right, you know. That way, when you go back through this, you can be like, who put this assembly with a giant brick on it, and why do they have these mates? And then you can delete these and go to these specifically instead of digging through everything.
So just out of curiosity, like, show us how the solar panels is mated.
Oh, yeah, sure. Let me turn off the section view. So solar modules are done. These right here are replication things. I think I went over this in another video. Yep. But I'll hide those real quick. And if I can find solar top view to minus X. So what this is it's a fastened connection. So that'll just take any hole. Maybe it would be easier if I just delete it and just redo it. So this is the whole solar assembly. Let's pull that off real quick. It should move. So what I'm doing is I'm selecting the I'll get rid of the replicate thing too. So I'll select the fastened mate, and then really kind of select any hole. Because all the holes are concentric, it doesn't matter, right? If it's the actual fastener or if it's the hole in the PCB, but it should be the PCB, because this surface right here is going to be exactly planar to the surface on the frame. So I selected the hole on the PCB, and I'll come up here and I'll select the hole here, and then it'll just snap right into place. And because it's a fastened mate, basically what that means is that it can't move left, right, up, down, rotate, or anything like that. So it's one single mate to mate the solar panel to the frame like that.
In reality, when it could actually rotate, a fastened mate won't actually rotate in CAD. Okay, gotcha.
That's right, yeah. So it's keeping the whole thing in place by only one point, which isn't actually realistic. But the thing is it's like a fine simplification, because you know all the other holes are going to be fine. If you really want to, you can like spin it around too. So we have our one solar panel, and then we want to do is we want to replicate this instance of the, oh, no, I want to replicate the whole solar assembly. Solar modules one was the one. And so then it'll auto-populate which mate to replicate, which is that latest one there. And then we'll just match individual edges, because I'll show you what happens otherwise. If you match edges on plane and you click this plane, it'll put a solar panel at every single hole. So you wanna match individual edges and then only select the edge that we made it over there. So I'll put one there, I'll put one there, and then just like that, you got you have solar panels. One really big outstanding problem that I haven't figured out how to deal with or what to do, and this is an outstanding problem, is in SOLIDWORKS you had center planes for everything, and it kept the center of like mass relative to the center of like the CubeSat relatively positioned, right? But with this, there's no planes in the assembly, which is a really kind of hard thing to do. But the origin is like down here, right? Which is not at the center of the satellite. And so when I do my mass calculations, this might actually take a while to update stuff, but like all of these center of mass things are going to be relative to that origin, which is like not good.
And you can't set this. You can't set the origin.
You can do. So I had a way of thinking of doing that, where you can do like different mates and stuff like that across different like frames. But at the same time, it's not. It's just slightly different than SOLIDWORKS. So I wasn't confident that it would put it in the exact same spot. It's an outstanding issue that I might be able to fix before I head out. But I'll keep you updated.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Well, at the worst, I mean, we know the offset from where that point is to the center of the satellite, so we can always
track totally. It. Yeah. You can. Yeah. That'd be fun.
Oh, but all the mass moment of inertias are wrong too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yep.
Yep. That's that. Oh, and if you want to generate a bomb table, this right over here is the bomb table feature, and then it should pull in every single here. If you want to add a column of like the name, it'll populate the name of everything, which has like the part numbers and stuff like that. I didn't go through the McMaster cars and put in a part number for them, but if you want to do that, can have somebody do that, but it has the name at least of every single component. That's right there if you want. And then you can just be able to export this pretty easily. I don't know how to export it, but I'm sure you can figure that one out. Yeah. That's what we're set.
That's pretty great. I'm trying to think about what other things we should go over. Have you gone through your list?
Yeah, that was my whole list. I did the branching stuff, the file structure, the frames, and then the cards. And the backplane was a separate add-on I didn't even think of. And then we did the solder. Anything else is like just regular CAD, right? Or like regular walkthrough stuff, like a DX Wi-Fi card or like CFC is just, it's CFC, right? I don't know. It's just CAD. It's just kind of self-explanatory.
Yeah, okay. Excellent. Let's call it done for now.
Yeah, cool. If you ever need to call me in and have me do a CAD tutorial, let me know.
Oh, don't worry. You'll never leave for real.
Oh, great.
Oh, wait. I should stop recording before other people hear this. Oh, man. Thanks. Thank you, Hayden. That was great. Really appreciate
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. Yeah.
All right. I'm going to stop the recording.